Good morning and welcome to the 25th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2024. I've received no apologies for this meeting. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 4 and 5 in private and whether to consider oral evidence on the National Care Service Bill taken at future meetings in private at those meetings. Are members agreed? Thank you. The next item on our agenda is the first session as part of our scrutiny of the Scottish Government's proposed Stage 2 amendments to the National Care Service Scotland Bill. And I welcome to the committee Keir Greenaway, Senior Organiser at GMB Scotland, Simon McFarland, Regional Manager, Unison, Katie McGregor, Policy and Public Affairs Lead, Royal College of Occupational Therapists, representing the Allied Health Professions Federation Scotland, and Colin Pullman, Director of the Royal College of Nursing Scotland. And we'll move straight to questions. And Tess White.
Good morning, panel. My first question is for Keir Greenaway, please. So, Keir, in your opinion, what impact would shared accountability arrangements have on the workforce?
So, our members in the GMB are unhappy with the bill as it currently stands, and we've made that clear. They've voted to renege on our support for the bill, and that's because they don't see any future in it. It doesn't achieve anything that they are looking for. We have put a lot of energy, a lot of time, a lot of effort. Our reps, which are frontline workers in private care and in care in the public sector, have put a lot of energy into it, and they don't see it going any moving forward in a way that would be suitable for them. They see their terms and conditions not being improved by the bill so far. They see pay not being improved by the bill so far. They don't see any voice for them on the national board. We've consistently asked for trade union seats on that national board, and we have we've not seen any. We knew there wasn't going to be a lot of detail in the bill itself. We've had no commitments. We've had no reassurance that there would be trade union seats on that national board. So, from our members' perspective, they've lost time on the bill, and they don't see a way forward for it.
Thank you. And a follow-up question. So, in your submission, you said the NCS board will be just another layer of bureaucracy in an already bloated sector, unable to tackle the issues of those caring and receiving care. Could you just elaborate on that?
Well, yeah, so we were hoping the National Care Service would bring forward monitoring and enforcement of of private sector providers, because we know that's where our members are most vulnerable. Their terms and conditions are most vulnerable, their pay is most vulnerable, and how they are treated in the workplace is most vulnerable. But we don't see any teeth in the bill. There's no active reassurance that there's going to be reform of IJBs. IJBs are wholly undemocratic at this moment in time. You have votes taking place where you will see the elected councillors voted down and decisions on cuts made. So for us, there's no way forward on it at this moment in time.
Thank you. And Simon, for Unison, in terms of the impact on the workforce, do you have something to add?
Yeah, I mean, the impact on the workforce is going to be negligible in terms of what this NCS delivers. And that's the fundamental problem of social care. You can't talk about social care without talking about the crisis in social care. And the crisis is a staffing crisis, and that's won by a failed market that doesn't deliver for care recipients, and it fails to deliver for care workers. We have a care service or care services built on £12 an hour in 2024, and that's just unsustainable and incredible. So we have long championed a national care service. One of the first people to argue and advocate it, but we believe we need a real national care service, which we've sent you information on before, and that has to start with the fundamentals of removing the market, the failed market in social care, expanding public provision and investing in staff that deliver care.
And the shared accountability of the NCS board, the impact of that?
Well, it's not been delivered. The Verity House Agreement talked about shared accountability between the NHS, local government and the Scottish Government. But the proposals you have in front of you today, such as they are, and we are at this stage of the bill in a unique situation where we're working on the hoof to some extent, but the Verity House Agreement hasn't been delivered in terms of shared accountability for local government. We still see the power line with the ministers to determine which services are in and out of scope and to take, ultimately, to step in and intervene and completely remove democratic local control.
OK, thank you. My second question is about the impact of shared accountability arrangements on those who use the social care and support services. So, Keir, can I ask you as well for the GMB to answer that question?
Sorry, could you repeat that?
Yes. What impact would shared accountability arrangements have on those who use social care and support services?
There is no clarity on regarding the board about where the shared accountability will come from, and because we haven't been given any assurances that there will be trade union seats on that board, and that means without the trade union seats on that board, then we aren't able to raise through that board the workers' perspective that are on the front line delivering the service, and so we would expect the board to be reflective of that and to have frontline workers at the heart of what's going on, because they're the ones that see, know and deliver what is happening absolutely every day.
In your submission papers, you talked about the GMB have said these plans only add bureaucracy to a service that's already choking on it. Would you like to say anything additional?
Well, I mean, like, we don't see how the introduction of the NCS as it currently stands will drive monitoring and enforcement, because there's very little in the bill about how it will do that. We have asked about IJB reform. There's no discussion about IJB reform. There's nothing in the bill that gives us confidence that it will drive up pay, terms and conditions of our members. And that's got to be key to deliver a national care service that we want. I mean, as Simon pointed to, then I mean, like, we all are in favour of a national care service. The national care service, a national care service as a concept, has got wide support, but this bill unfortunately doesn't have that support because it doesn't deliver on that.
Thank you. And the same question, would you like me to repeat it for Simon, for Unison?
I think, I mean, the issue about the board and shared accountability is this bill, as it stands, doesn't deliver on it. And it is still the major concern at stage one was a power grab on local government, and significant elements of that remain. That's why you have submissions in front of you from COSLA setting that out. But we, you know, so yes, we expect if this progresses that there'll be a workers' voice on that board, but we don't think that's sufficient to counter the impact of removing local democratic control. And the issue in care, it's not complicated. What people need is quality, they need consistency, and they need time. And this bill doesn't deliver on any of those for the people receiving care or the people delivering care. And that's the fundamental problem in social care in Scotland. It's a lack of those elements, and that comes down to resources and the significant extraction of the money that is in the system through private profit and offshoring of the limited resources that are invested in social care in Scotland.
Just do a follow-up on that. So very brief. So you talk about the shared accountability of the board being a quango risking creating confusion. Could you elaborate upon that?
Yeah, well, the board that's going to be a new structure, and it's going to oversee the strategy for the NCS. But as I say, the strategy is not complicated. People need quality, they need consistency, and they need more time and care. And we've known that for a long, long time. But what the NCS board does do is it takes away democratic local control, both from local government and it would appear also from the NHS in terms of the services that come out of the boards.
Thank you, Convener.
Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Thanks for being with us. Keir Greenaway, if I could just come back to you on one of the questions that Tess White asked. Hear you loud and clear about union representation on the board. She asked what difference that could make to service users, and I appreciate that unions are here about paying conditions for their workforce, but obviously what difference could having frontline workers represented make to service users themselves?
So thanks for that question. I think if we talk about how we would expect a board to be made up, it would be the trade unions on that board that would be representative of the staff that see those service users absolutely every day. We know our members, our reps, are just as passionate about the service users as they are about their pay terms and conditions. So for us, having a link straight into the service users, which is the people that look after them, the people who care for them absolutely every day, it would be invaluable. And that's why it shouldn't just be a seat at the table. It should be a large, impactful voice in the room.
Thank you. And just on a point of clarity, you said that GMB had withdrawn support for the bill. Had it ever formally supported the bill in its form? I appreciate that you support a national care service, but
we'd spent hours and endless resource engaging with the bill, trying to get it into a shape that would deliver for our members, and we are now going to concentrate our efforts elsewhere, because it's for the amount of resource and time and effort that we put into it. And this is also asking it's not just paid officials of the trade union, it's care workers themselves giving up their time to take part and be consulted on around the bill. We think their time is better used elsewhere.
Okay. Do any other panel members have comments on that importance of having union voice at the board? Katie?
Thank you. So I'm here today representing the Allied Health Professions Federation Scotland, which represents 12 professional bodies of those AHPs across Scotland and collectively make up the third largest clinical workforce. And professions included in that are such as speech and language therapists, physios, occupational therapists, and so on. And I guess I would really just echo kind of the points that Keir and Simon have been making around that representation at that strategic board level, and it really needs to be included in the bill so they have that statutory footing, so there is that guaranteed input and there is that representation at that level, because if we don't have those people and those voices statutory footing, then they'll... You risk losing that representation, and it's those people that really understand what the issues are, understand what the challenges are, and also understand what the solutions are. And I think from our point of view, you know, it's a very well known issue within the crisis in social care, and it's time we used this as an opportunity to build on that and not just produce bills and create new agencies that don't then have that representation within it to deliver against these challenges.
Colin.
Thank you. This is complex. I mean, the one thing that we do welcome is the proposal that all members of the National Care Service Board would have full voting rights. We think that's really extremely important. Of course, we absolutely believe that workers should be represented through trade unions, but we also believe that the complexity of care requires to be represented. So, for example, from a strategic nursing point of view, expertise needs to be there, because what we really need to appreciate that care is much more complex than it's ever been, and that that includes in social care. And if the people who are not there with the expertise, as well as the representatives, we're not going to deliver for the people that we're here to deliver for. So I think it's really, really important that we get the makeup of the National Care Board correct.
Thank you. Simon.
It's important to remember that the social care is largely provided by low-paid women in Scotland, many of whom are part-time, and as well as Keir says, caring passionately about the people they care for in their work. Many, many of our members are unpaid carers themselves, looking after family members, and face all the challenges that we all face in terms of navigating through the care service. So they have a dual and a unique voice, both as care professional caregivers, but as individual caregivers. And obviously we represent thousands of social workers across Scotland as well, and it's very important that their voice is heard and represented within the National Care Service Board as well.
Thank you. Thanks, Camilla.
Sanjeev Gohani.
Thank you. Just a declaration of interest as a practising NHS GP. Keir and Simon, can I ask you about the shared accountability agreement? If COSLA withdraw their support for the National Care Service, would you say that this bill would be dead in the water?
Well, I mean, I think COSLA have submitted huge reservations about it, and that's one of the unique, integrated, unifying things about this bill is it has united a raft of Civic Scotland to come out and either oppose it or say that it needs huge amendment. But so far, the government seems determined to progress this bill. Unison's position is that the bill should be withdrawn and we should get back to consultation and engagement about a bill that will deliver a real national care service that will have the trust, confidence, and support of not just Unison trade unions but wider Civic Scotland. So I still think at this stage our message to the government is roll back from this bill. Let's get back around the table and get something that's fit for purpose. But I think you see the extent of concern from COSLA in relation to the proposals and the threat that they see in terms of the power grab, the lack of democratic control, and the failure to deliver on that commitment that was given in the Verity House agreement about shared accountability, because the shared accountability isn't in the amendments. The power and responsibility still lies with entire, you know, ultimately with the minister.
I think it would definitely be another nail in its coffin. But I think what's probably more important is that the Scottish Government should see the lack of enthusiasm and the lack of support from the workers who deliver care every day. And that comes from their voice through their trade unions, who have made it clear that there's no support for this bill at this moment in time in the shape that it's in. But there is wide-ranging support for a national care service, which tells you that the bill is not appropriate in its current form.
Can I ask you, in the Royal College of Occupational Therapists submission to us, they talk about multiple pressures facing the body that provides services, and the NCS must turn the tide on these structural and systemic pressures. Could you elaborate a little bit more about what the multiple pressures facing the body for occupational therapists are, please?
I can, with the caveat that I'm here to represent AHPFS and not just occupational therapists. I guess what the point of that was that for occupational therapists, in the context of the NCS, is that we have them employed currently by local authorities, with the exception of Highland, who obviously have a different integration agreement. And there's many challenges within that, particularly within teams that have occupational therapists, that have social workers, that also have occupational therapists employed by the NHS, and they have different terms and conditions for their contracts versus the ones that are employed by local authorities. So what we would hope to see within the NCS is for that to be redressed and for that parity between those two different employers to be redressed, and there to be parity between the care service and the NHS. Similarly, we have huge concerns over the National Social Work Agency, which is proposed as within the bill.
All right, okay. So I don't want to take anyone's thunder. But does the NCS address what you've just said?
I don't believe it does in its current form, no. I think, as has been mentioned already, that the vision of the NCS and the principles that are behind it is something that we do support. And many of the principles, or all of the principles that have been outlined in the bill, are something that allied health professions already very much delivered against. We've got a position paper on it, which has been shared with you. And it's nice to have this nice vision and these nice principles, but what is the outcome going to be from it? What are the practical things that are going to change as a result of it? And we don't have enough detail in this bill that tells us what is going to happen as a result. Is there going to be parity within those professions? Is there going to be the resources and the funding and the support and the workforce planning that needs, all these things that need to be done, all the practical things that need to be done to turn that tide on this crisis? Because the principles are a really nice idea and we can all agree with them and support with them, but ultimately, what is the practical changes? What is the? We don't know anything about the funding. There's been no financial indications to what is going to be the result of this bill. And until we have further detail on that, I think it's hard for us to comment on the efficacy of the bill at this point.
Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to everybody. It's just to pick up on a question about board membership. There's amendments, there's 25 pages of amendments put in the bill, and it's page 60 under chapter, part 4, chapter 2, there's a load of subsections about membership of the bill, and I think it's just to pick up on your point, Keir, about people who should be representative on the board, and one of the subsections talks about an individual appointed on the basis that ministers believe that that individual will make an important contribution to the board's work on account of the individual's being or having been a carer within the meaning given by the section. So my understanding is, that's already a part of a proposed amendment that carers will be part of the membership of a board. But I'm interested in the fact that it is a framework bill with a co-design process in process, and that's started already. So I'm seeking to understand if you think that does that need to be clarified further in terms of, like, more laid out that a board membership should contain membership of the union, for instance?
Yeah, I think you should go further. My understanding of that amendment is it's a single person who is a carer and not someone who is representative of thousands, tens of thousands of carers within the sector. So I think that does need to go further, because there should be a trade union voice on there for carers within the sector, but also ancillary staff. The ancillary staff need to be represented through the board as well, whether that's domestics, whether it's laundry, people working in laundries, or however they whatever sort of skill set they have within the care sector. So I do think it needs to go further.
So it needs to be maybe some more clarifying language that kind of encompasses that, as in board membership to represent wider workforce within the care sector.
Definitely, and we've been raising this for months and probably years now to every cabinet secretary that we meet regarding the National Care Service. The trade unions need to have a seat at the table, and why the trade unions need to have a seat at the table.
Thanks,
Fitzpatrick.
Briefly, I think both Simon and Keir suggested that one of the reasons for their opposition to the bill was that what they described as a power grab and a loss of local accountability. And I think Simon in particular mentioned Verity House a couple of times, so I think probably for the record that I was the minister responsible, along with the then Deputy First Minister, for taking Verity House forward. One of the key aspects of Verity House is that the government should not interfere in pay negotiations which are devolved. So I guess, how do we get this bit when you're saying, on one hand, we should respect the Verity House and there should be local accountability, but on the other hand, every time there's a pay dispute, I think both GMB and... both unions would come forward and say the government should get involved against what Verity House says. And yes, the other thing that I would like just a quick comment on is, as MSPs, we frequently hear constituents complaining about what they would call a postcode lottery.
and that care services are different depending on where you live. And I guess, how do we balance that call by people who use the services across Scotland with your call for local accountability? Either Simon or Ciarán.
Well, of course, the Verity House Agreement said absolutely nothing about the council tax freeze, which took tens of millions of pounds out of local government and made the situation in relation to local government pay impossible. So, the government needs to play fair, and it didn't with the council tax freeze, and we still suffer the consequences. That, well, you reference the Verity House Agreement, and I'm telling you why pay is so fraught in local government, because it's so underfunded by the Scottish Government. It's been, and that has been the situation for many years. But the reality of pay in social care is that it's unacceptably low, and that's why we have a crisis in social care, and that it's predicated this moment on £12 an hour, which is just not a credible rate for the highly skilled caring work that our members are asked to deliver. So in terms of the power grab issue, it does remain that it should be for local democratically elected politicians to have the responsibility for delivering the care services locally and employing the staff. Now, whilst the staffing issue for now has been resolved, there remains the provisions in the bill to direct that services are nationally provided, and there is even the suggestion that provision of services could be transferred from one National Care Service local board to another. Now, exactly how that would work and how it would impact on staff, like many things in the bill, is entirely unclear. But it's a matter for concern that swathes of local, services run by one local authority could appear to be taken into control of the government and given to another NCS board to run.
Thank you. I mean, obviously, I didn't come here to talk about pay and the Verity House Agreement, but I would echo Simon's words. The Verity House Agreement would have ruled out a council tax freeze, as far as I can see. And when it comes to pay, we ask for increased funding for local government to deliver a pay rise. But on the national board, I think in the GMB we were looking for it to have more teeth than it does have in the bill, in monitoring and enforcing standards, because we've got thousands and thousands of members in private care, and they need that monitoring and enforcement of standards on their own terms and conditions, and for the people they look after to drive terms and to drive care and to drive and increase their pay in terms and conditions.
So actually, you're asking for a national board with more powers, which potentially would be taken. The power, if power goes to there, it must be coming from somewhere else if it's shared. But you want it to be meaningful.
Monitoring enforcement powers to make sure that service level, the quality of service, and terms and conditions and pay are being delivered for care workers and for care users.
Okay, that's helpful. Thank you.
David Torrens.
I think Colin. Could I come in on the point around about pay and bargaining within social care? Whether you do it within a national care service or do somewhere else, it's a disgrace how we pay people in social care and those who work, especially for third-party organisations, both in contracting and around about how we negotiate pay terms and conditions. If we're going to make progress, there needs to be equality across health and social care, and it's a major issue for us. We've got a workforce crisis, and if we don't grab it, it's going to continue, it's going to get worse.
Apologies for asking you, Katie, if you wanted to comment on that.
David Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the witnesses. My question is around the National Care Service principles and fair work. So to what extent do you think the amended principles relating to fair work is a better reflection and provides greater reassurance as to how fair work should be embedded in National Care Service services? Not to anybody.
I mean, our experience of fair... I mean, we support that, of course, we do the fair work agenda, but our experience has not been wholly positive in terms of public authorities tend to ask us to sign up to agreements talking about how they treat their own staff, and we're trying to push that out to say, well, it's not just about how you treat your own staff and engage with us as direct employees and their representatives, it's about how you treat and how the workers of commissioned services are treated, and that nowhere is that more prevalent in social care, where we have, as I said earlier, a failed market that sees people employed on £12 an hour. We know from COVID that the sector is rife with employers that don't pay sick pay, and to the extent that the government had to step in and underwrite sick pay so that people with COVID didn't continue to go to the work during the crisis. So, but yet, a few years after COVID, when there was money committed to delivering sick pay across the sector, then last year the government took that money away, the missing millions, as we refer to it. And so we still have a service where many people are employed in social care but don't have sick pay. So they might not, well, they could still be going to their work with COVID today. So the failed market and the treatment of staff within it is a huge issue. And so we have had Fair Work in Scotland for a period of time. For even longer, we've had the notion of ethical commissioning. But we can see all around us these mechanisms completely fail to deliver for the workforce and the people that receive the care.
On the Fair Work, obviously we want a Fair Work embedded within any national care service, but we're concerned about the bill as it stands. There's not enough teeth within it to be able to enforce it. We're in multiple Fair Work working groups at the moment, which are moving glacially slowly. And as Colin points out, it's a failure that we do not have sectoral bargaining within the sector. And until we have workers able to bargain for themselves within the sector, and we empower those workers to bargain for themselves, we will not get over the poor wages, terms and conditions within the sector.
Cool.
Thank you, Mr. Todd. I think, we're clear the bill doesn't go far enough in relation to the Fair Work, nor does it, as colleagues have said around about the principle, how that would be enforced by the bill. I think that's incredibly important. I mean, as I've said, I'm here to represent nursing staff, and nursing staff should have equity of pay, terms and conditions wherever they work. But what they also should have is the support systems in place to support them. And Fair Work covers that as well. So Fair Work covers around about training and development and how we recruit people but also retain them. So we think that needs to be strengthened within the bill.
I would echo completely with what Colin said there. For us, again, it's kind of about that parity and representation piece. So for us, it's about allied health professions having the pay terms and conditions that are reflective of their quality of the work that they're delivering and the services that they're delivering. But also it's around that career opportunity, that progression, what opportunities are there for training and development, what resources are available, is it that it's relevant to their area of service. So for example, at the moment for us, particularly for occupational therapists working within local authority teams, they do not have the same access to training and opportunity developments as those in the NHS, because NESs aren't always the opportunities aren't always applicable to the setting of local authorities. So it's really about that parity between those different professions and those different settings. But also it's about giving staff the opportunity to have an effective voice and to be able to influence decisions at that level. And again, it goes back to the representation that you can't, you really need to engage with people in a really meaningful way to ensure that anything, whether it be Fair Work, is delivered in a meaningful way and isn't just a principle, if you like, but actually is deliverable and has a positive outcome.
Can I come on that point around the amendments about Fair Work? Do you think they're strong enough for employers, and I'm talking about the private sector here, to make a minimum standard and ensure that a set of standards are there for employees?
I don't think they're strong enough. So we've seen that we're 5 years on from the Fair Work Convention report on social care, and it has made very, very little difference to the experience of care workers in Scotland. We do have some glimmer of hopes around sectoral bargaining, some progress being made there, and collective voice. But on the whole, as Ciara said, the progress has been torturously slow, and we're in danger in Scotland of being overtaken by developments in England from the Westminster government in relation to social care and collective bargaining there. So, no, the amendments aren't strong enough. And the other issue to be aware of is the limited rules and regulations and toolkits we have around ethical procurement. Is that completely fails because local government is so hollowed out, and the ability to monitor contracts and enforce contract compliance and evaluate what's going on the ground just isn't there. There just isn't the resources and the people to do it. So there is huge under delivery against contracts already in Scotland, and that's part of the failed market in social care.
I don't think the fair work within the bill goes far enough. And although Simon says there is progress in sectoral bargaining, but even within that progress, we see private sector employers pushing back at the involvement of trade unions, being able to talk to workers within the sector for them to have a voice within their own sectoral bargaining. So we can see that there is pushbacks everywhere. We have not made enough progress to be delivering for workers in the workplace, and they don't see the difference of what's happened in the last 5 years, really. So there is a lot more to do, and I don't think the fair work within the bill goes far enough.
Cole?
I agree with colleagues' submissions, but I think also the important thing we need to remember is if we're going to improve the experience of the workforce wherever they work, we need to make sure that whether it's a statutory provider or not, that they have the adequate resources to make sure that they can provide what's been asked of, and that sometimes isn't allowed for when you come to contracting, for example. So that really needs to be looked at.
Yeah, I would agree. And I also wonder how it also links in with other pieces of legislation, so the Safe Staffing Act and things like that. It's how do you, you've got all these different strands, and it's how do you make sure that they're aligned and it's the best outcome and best conditions and most effective working arrangements for those individuals, because ultimately if they don't have the support they need, then there'll be negative consequences for that as well. But I would just agree that as it stands, that the amendments don't go far enough, and it's what are the consequences of not being met. That remains unclear from the bill.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks to the panel for their contributions so far. Just keen to understand more about what continuing work we can do in the meantime, whilst we, considering this further legislation, what we could do to expedite continuing progress on, for example, Anne's Law, and looking at how we can pull that forward.
We're actually going to come on to that further on in the themes, Mr. Sweeney.
Oh, I do apologise. I thought that was where we were at.
No, we're on theme two.
All right, I do apologise.
Okay. Carol Morgan.
Thank you, Convener. I just want to, pick up really on a point around the importance of social care being seen as this, a very professional workforce, which I think we can all agree. And there's two points. There's a sense that we're very slow in, getting that justice for that workforce. So I suppose my question is, particularly around sectoral collective bargaining stuff, should we be looking at, we need to do things now, as well as trying to, if this bill moves forward, making robust, advancements on what would be in the bill. But is there something that we should be doing? Can we do things now around fair work and particularly bargaining?
Yeah, absolutely. We don't need this bill to deliver sectoral bargaining, we should have got on with that by now. As has been said, progress has been far too slow to be made. So the government need to deliver on that. I mean, even if this bill does progress, it's still got a long way to go, and much of it's going to be done, as it appears at present, by secondary legislation. But we need delivery on fair pay and collective bargaining now. At the moment, we are balloting members in Enable, a large social care charity in Scotland, over pay. But it's pretty much a dispute by proxy, because we know that Enable's one of the better employers. We've just written a joint letter with us to the government, which has been signed by over 500 of our members and their families, around the whole issue. We need investment in social care, and that can only come from the Scottish Government. But I've also said that we need to tackle the market, because just pouring in money, even if there were money, then unless you tackle the profit extraction and the offshoring, then much of that money is going to continue to leach out. So there is much that can be done just now. It doesn't require the bill, and certainly not this bill, and the government should be getting on with that, because otherwise we remain in a state of crisis.
Yeah, we absolutely agree. There is no barrier in our view that sectoral collective bargaining could not be progressed at the moment. And in fact, it would enhance the progress of, if you're moving towards the bill, whether we agree the complete content of the bill or not, sectoral collective bargaining is something all of us, especially in the trade union and professional organisations, would support government in moving forward.
Yeah, I mean, we're in exactly the same position from the GMB. There's no reason why we can't expedite sectoral bargaining for April 25 next year. I think there are no barriers. You'll find no barriers on this side of the table for that. And with Scottish Government supporting us in the push for that, then I think that helps us build the confidence of those working in the sector that the Scottish Government is on their side and willing to deliver for them.
Just once more, you've mentioned the Missing Millions campaign. Is there any sense that the government are picking up on this notion that we should be seeking to remove sort of the private sector from the provision of service, or any engagement on that matter at all?
No, quite the converse. The bill, as it proposes, talks about it's certainly about maintaining the market. It does have provisions in there about expanding third sector provision, but that is, it's not about taking business, if you want to put it that way, out of the private sector. It's about specifically excluding the public sector and local government from providing services. And what we're clear about is the only way that we can get out of the crisis is by increasing the not-for-profit and the public sector provision of care and social care in Scotland, and that doesn't seem to be part of the government's agenda at all. They seem still committed to maintaining a failed market which sees huge amounts of profit extraction from Scotland. And just one very quick anecdote, and one of my colleagues had to...
We're really pressed for time.
Okay.
We're over halfway through, Mr. Okay. McFarlane. So you maybe add that in at another part.
Okay.
Did you have something else that you wanted to ask, Carol?
That's okay. Fine. Thank you.
Apologies for cutting you off. No. Sanjesh Gohan.
Thank you, convener. Keir, can I ask? So your union engaged with the NCS bill for 2 years now. What, in your opinion, does the National Care Board do, and what is it for?
We wanted to see it as have like teeth around enforcement and monitoring to make sure that the level of service for care users was enhanced, and that it could enforce proper fair work within the private care sector to bring up people's terms and conditions and pay. And how we see it in the bill currently is it doesn't have those teeth to be able to do that. And that will just mean if it doesn't have that teeth to be able to do that, what is it there for? And that's why we point to it being an added level of bureaucracy that's not required. We don't think the sector delivers as it stands, but adding a level of bureaucracy to it won't make it any better. So we really wanted to see the National Care Service be that positive driver for change, and it doesn't read as though it will be within the bill.
So adding another layer of bureaucracy, which would be the National Care Board, and then we've got IJBs, which are going to be renamed. We also have HSCPs and a whole load of other acronyms. So Do you think a patient or actually understands what all these agencies are and where to go if they have a problem?
I would imagine that most won't. And we know that IJBs, as they currently stand, don't deliver, and they're very incredibly opaque about how decisions are made, where decisions are made. And you've got a mixture of people who are democratically elected, those that aren't democratically elected making decisions there. So that's not delivering for patients and care users at this moment in time, or for our members delivering care and the ancillary staff within the care server sector.
And do you think changing the name of an IJB to a health board or a health service board or whatever we're going to change the name to, but essentially it'll have the same people on it, won't it? So what's that going to be different?
I mean, there needs to be fundamental change, and that's what we all hoped the National Care Service would deliver, and that's why we're all supportive of the National Care Service. We see the care sector as not delivering as well as it could for service users, and definitely not delivering for those people on the front line delivering care. So we were all supportive of a National Care Service, and just rebadging stuff won't fix things.
And Simon spoke about the £38 million that's been ripped away from the National Care workforce. And I think Carol asked a question around it, but is the NCS addressing this and putting that £38 million back into the workforce?
In our view, it doesn't guarantee to do that. That money is missing and there's no sign of its return. What we do hope is that out with the NCS, that we move towards sectoral bargaining in 2025. And within that, then clearly the trade unions will be pursuing core terms, conditions and guarantees, and sick pay will be very high in the agenda. But that will take money and it will take resources, and that money will need to be put in by the Scottish Government for that sectoral bargaining to deliver anything. But there's no sign of it coming back any time soon, no.
Okay. Thank you.
Emma Harper.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener. I'm interested in just a couple of questions about the creation of a National Chief Social Work Advisor and the National Social Work Agency. The Care Inspectorate seemed to support the approach being taken by the Scottish Government, saying that we believe that the placing the role of National Social Work Agency and National Chief Social Work Advisor on a statutory footing recognises the unique role of social work and will ensure it is given due parity and prominence within the National Care Service. So I'd be interested, I know we've got Social Work Scotland in as a next panel, but I'll be interested to hear what your views are on the proposals to create a role of a Chief Social Work Advisor and the National Social Work Agency, and what would you envisage that they would like to then see as them playing and supporting the profession and also the social work services?
Pick us off. So, from EHPFS point of view, we are opposed to the creation of a National Social Work Agency, and instead would like to see an agency that's created to include all professions that are involved in the delivery of social care services. So, what our concerns are with an agency that is exclusive to one profession is that it becomes divisive, it creates silos, it doesn't improve multidisciplinary working, and it doesn't improve integration, which, as we know, is a very patchy picture across Scotland as it stands. By putting the National Social Work Advisor on a statutory footing, again, it doesn't allow for that parity between the professions that are involved within social care. Social care is not delivered exclusively by social workers, and whilst they are the largest workforce and what they do is very important and they need as much investment and support, we need to be mindful that they're not the only professions involved in the delivery of social care. So what we would want to see is an agency that is inclusive of all those professions and opportunities, funding, training and development, workforce modelling, workforce planning, all those things that we need to see to improve the outcomes for social care in Scotland are available to all the professions, including allied health professions, who are delivering those services. So I think whilst the idea to create a national body, which might allow for national standards to be created and things like that, it needs to be inclusive of all those professions.
So brings me to my next question. So that if there was a national social work agency, and you know we would know that local authorities and health boards and care boards would have to kind of work together so that they wouldn't be working in silos. So is there something that you think it could be done different then as to what is proposed in terms of what would a chief social worker do in terms of, you know, basically eliminating silos?
I think we already have a chief social worker. We have a chief allied health professions officer, and my understanding is that those working relationships could perhaps be improved. Whether we need another agency to do that, you know, the Scottish, over 100 quangos, government agencies as it stands, do we need another agency to deliver these changes? And I just think creating the creation of this agency in response to, you know, a crisis within social care, I don't think the creation of the agency is going to solve the issues that need solved. I don't quite understand through the bill how the relationship with the National Social Work Agency and the National Care Service Board, what that relationship is, who holds the power, who holds the funding, who holds the autonomy, who is represented at which. So I think, again, it's just the lack of detail around it and the implications of it is where our concerns are. But with what we do know, we can't support an agency that is set up just for one profession when it's not just one profession that's delivering the services.
OK.
We certainly in unison support the National Social Work Agency, but similar to shared accountability, the proposal in the bill doesn't deliver what we thought was agreed, which was supposed to be a partnership between COSLA, Social Work Scotland and the Scottish Government. And instead, it appears we've got a vehicle for the Chief Social Work Officer. So there's still a lot of work to be done around this proposal. We're not comfortable it delivers. What we wanted was an agency that focused on developing the profession, investing in training and support and development, and looking at the whole social workforce. But we seem to have an agency that only is on... It's focused around the chief social work officer and not the partner, the partnership that we were promised. So we have significant concerns about that, and would hope that will be addressed as the legislation progresses.
And so, again, this is a framework bill. So you would be keen to make sure that further regulation, statutory instruments were very good at defining what the role of the social work agency and the chief social worker was responsible for, so that as we develop the regulations going down the line, that everybody's clear on whose role and responsibilities are.
Yes, and I mean the role of, as has been said, the chief social worker has been around for a long time, and their role, as I understand it, is to advise the Scottish Government on social work issues. But the agency was hoped to be much broader than that in terms of advancing the standing of the profession, trying to get us out of the crisis mode that we're in social work, where it's about managing resources rather than improving lives and outcomes for the people that they support, and looking at fundamental developments in the service. And we would hope that through dialogue with ourselves, Social Work Scotland, COSLA, we can get back onto that agenda.
Okay, thanks.
Gillian McKay.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to the panel. I've kind of got the theme that covers everything else that we haven't already spoken about, so apologies if this turns into just a bit of a random run round the bill. We've obviously had a chat about what so far, about the unions obviously now having withdrawn their support for the bill and looking for the bill to be withdrawn in some cases, and other organisations still in the works to try and make it better. There are obviously some good things in the bill in terms of those receiving care, ANZ law, right to short breaks, advocacy provisions that are within the bill. Does the panel believe that we're at the stage now where we need to go back to the drawing board on some of the reorganisation and some of the things around fair work, but are needing to get some progress on the good things so that we don't lose any more of the goodwill that is left around some of the co-design that has already happened, absolutely appreciating what people have said so far about the workforce's input to co-design and how the workforce are feeling. There is obviously on the other side of that people who receive care, their families who have put their time in as well and have seen something come from some of that. So would the panel support that position where we get the good things we can and have a wider conversation around what whole-scale reform looks like with more detail?
I would agree with what you said, and to an extent, I think the good things in the bill, like Anne's Law, and we put it in our submission, is that we'd want to see that be expedited now, because I think we can understand that this bill has been in the works for a while. The end date of it is unknown to some extent, so we don't want to lose those good things. But do we need this bill to for them to be realised? So whether there's a way that could be delivered out with this bill, I think is worth considering.
Colin?
Yeah, I agree with Kate. I mean, at the end of the day, this has been a long and weary road, and we all have our views collectively. And I do feel for those who are carers who've inputted into it and who are looking for change as well. Everybody's looking for change, and we all agree with the principles. So I think it's around about working through what is there an ability that will be for government to work through whether we can deliver on things quicker. We talked about for the staff, sector, collective bargaining, but there's also many issues for those who receive services, but also their families, that could be taken forward without the need for this legislation.
We think that where the Parliament can make progress, it should. And I would say there's a wider issue about democracy and accountability and how this bill has been handled in terms of we're in an unprecedented situation today because of the approach of the government. And I don't think it's right for so much to be left for secondary legislation. And the issues that, one of the justifications for long grass in some of this or further discussions as the government portray it is so that agencies can focus on the winter and the discharges. But the whole point of a national care service is about prevention, and the focus should be on prevention but avoiding the scenarios that lead to those issues. So that's why, in terms of the issue about wider reform and discussion, absolutely. There are proposals in here about moving to one-size-fits-all across Scotland. That's a huge change from what we currently have, and particularly will impact in Highland. For all those reasons, we think that both the democratic issue and the practical issues, this bill should be withdrawn, and we should get back round the table and get that buy-in for a bill that's fit for purpose and will enjoy the wide trust and confidence of Civic Scotland.
Yeah, I would say that if we can progress the positives, and that's for those that receive care, but obviously from our perspective, it will be sectoral bargaining by April next year. That will instil confidence in our members and in those that receive care that we could return to a national care service that actually fulfilled the vision that people have got for a national care service that could deliver for them.
We obviously also have a patchy picture across the country in terms of which services the local authority deliver or don't, in terms of children and justice services as well. There are concerns from stakeholders, as I'm sure some of you have those concerns as well, about how that works in practice is for those who don't currently have all of those services being delivered by the local authority. Does anyone have views on how we square that circle for a start, and whether Children's and Justice Services should be taken under the bill as well? Katie?
The issue with justice, children and young people services is that, you know, there's been very little, there's no detail, I guess, in the bill on what that would look like, what the reality of that is. And even, you know, within EHPFS, within the 12 different professions, we have differing views on on children and young people services and how they would integrate into an NCS. So I think there needs to be significant more research, engagement done within those areas. And even on things, you know, like community healthcare is part of NCS, but what is community healthcare? What does that mean? There's a huge emphasis on early intervention, prevention, which EHPs and rehab form a massive part of, but again, there's little detail on that. So I think for all these areas of clinical practice and of services, there needs to be significant more research and detail given as to what the implications would mean for funding for the workforce and ultimately for the outcomes for the people that use the services.
As part of the process, the government commissioned research in both criminal justice and children's services, and it was inconclusive that there was any benefit to moving these services into scope. And the concern is that the one size fits all. It doesn't. Again, it's a removal of local accountability and decision making. And what is fundamentally required in both these areas of service is more resources. And this reorganisation will not deliver any more resources, which is what's needed. And as I do say, it will create particular problems for Highland. And in terms of the staff there went through a very protracted, choopy situation, which is not, even now, is not fully resolved. And a service which has been blighted in the past by bullying and Stirrock to introduce another upheaval, I don't think it is the right thing to do, and it could pose significant jeopardy.
That's great, thank you. For Colin and Katie, as organisations who still are working to try and make the bill better, what are the things that you would like to see in the bill in terms of amendments? Obviously, from a union side of things, collective bargaining, all that sort of good stuff, absolutely on board with all of that. But are there things for the workforces from your side?
I guess from our point of view, the main thing for us is that parity and representation piece, and it's having the statutory obligation or footing that there would be that allied health professions representation with voting rights, with on national boards, with on local boards, to feed into strategies, to feed into charters. And alongside that, just what we really also need to see is just more detail on what the financial implications of the bill would be, but also what the practical outcomes would be. And, you know, we want, as we said in our initial response and our response again this time, for us it's about looking at the outcomes of the bill. What does this mean for the people that are using the services and the people that are delivering the services? And at the moment, it's just it lacks any of that detail, in particular, as I say, around, you know, rehabilitation is mentioned within the principles of the bill, but there's nothing as to what does that definition of rehab mean, who's involved in that, what does that mean for the rehab services? And I think, you know, there's a huge opportunity here, and we're keen to work with committee and with government to drive that forward, but it's just been, been going on for so long now, we need to really start to look at what the practical things are that we can do.
A number of things. I could go on for a long time, but clearly representation from expert nursing, we believe that needs to be there around the National Care Board in itself. We need much more clarity in how governance would work. I mean, national monitoring is a good thing, but there needs to be more clarity around about how that would be enforced. That would be really important. One of the issues that we have significant concern is around about who would take accountability for workforce planning, for example. It would be split between three partners. Who's going to take the coordinating role, who's going to take the lead role, and how are we going to bring that for change? And of course, we've talked about bargaining, but I think the other thing is around about how do we train and develop and support our workforces across who would be covered by the National Care Service. So it's really, really important. These are a number of concerns, and we've raised these concerns consistently. We are, and we came out very clearly at stage one and said that we had real deep concerns about the bill and about progressing, but the government are progressing with it, and we'll continue to engage to try and make it as best that we can through the process.
Great. Thanks, Convener.
Carol Morgan.
Thank you, Convener. I think, you know, given the discussion about whether we believe it should progress or not progress, we still have to scrutinise the amendments, you know, as they stand. And so one of the things that I'm interested in this section is around, do we think the bill as it stands with the amendments, would this give us enough and a robust way of monitoring improvements in social care and making sure that we were able to look at the performance in social care for the outcomes for our clients. And you know, so do you think that the amendments as they stand would allow us to be able to do that if it was in place? Yeah.
I think so. Improved national oversight, monitoring and improvement has the potential to be hugely beneficial. And I think everybody agrees that. But I think the difficulty is, even with the amendments we have, there's not clarity around about how the shared accountability would work and how the governance would work. And I think it's a very complex sector, as we all know. And so from the point of the view at the moment of ourselves, is we believe that would have to be, there would have to be much more clarity put in place for it to work.
I would, yeah, totally agree with that. And also just how does it work with existing models of that evaluation of services, what already exists. We don't want this to become an extra burden on staff. And I guess it needs to also be done under the premise that it is for service improvements and that there will be support and any necessary funding available for that improvement to then be driven forward.
Monitoring takes resources, and we've seen, and I've tried to put in my evidence that has been hollowed out in terms of local government. There isn't the ability to hold providers to account for the services that they're contracted for. So you can put in all the regimes, all the toolkits, if the resources aren't there to ensure that they're delivered on, then the accountability is not there. And that's why, Frank, we think there needs to be much greater direct provision, public provision of social care, because ultimately direct accountability comes at the ballot box.
Yeah, and for us, I mean, that it's clear existing governance is not good enough, but the bill is not robust enough on governance to drive the improvements that our members need.
Just briefly, in terms of being able to really robustly, you know, monitor and see that we could put forward improvements that would work for people and staff members as well. Are we saying that we would need to see how we could make sure there was more funding available there, that it clearly wouldn't be doable, even if it was in writing clear what we had to do? We don't have the resources to actually implement that.
Funding is fundamental to the problems and the crisis we face in social care, but that can't be. But that's only one side of it. It's the huge amount of money that's extracted from the sector via private profit, and much of it offshored via opaque company structures. That we've got a company providing the care, renting a care home from a parent company, and then that's offshored. That all needs addressed, and it's only through direct public provision and an expanded role for the third sector that we can do that.
Thank you.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks to the panel. Just wanted to cover the proposed amendments from the Scottish Government, where the original principle referred to fair work has been replaced and a reference to ethical commissioning is removed from the bill. Do you have a view on whether these adjustments would strengthen or weaken the bill and the suggested link between fair work and ethical commissioning in the sector?
We'd like to take that.
Ethical commissioning has failed to deliver for many years, and whilst we support the fair work agenda, again, we're 5 years on from the Fair Work Commission report on social care, and it's not delivered on the ground. We need resources into social care. We need greater public and not-for-profit provision, and it's only by those measures that we can see improvements for the workforce in social care. Other mechanisms are blunt and have consistently failed. And we do hope sectoral bargaining in 2025 will make inroads in this, but we don't need this bill in order to deliver that.
I mean, a slightly different view. I mean, obviously, Scottish ministers have removed ethical commission, and we'd like to understand why that is. I can't understand why that is the case. I think to have ethical commission in there is a good principle for us all to follow, so I can't understand why you would remove it.
Do you have any other questions, Mr. Sweeney?
No, I think that pretty much covers it. Do you have a view about any amendments that you would prefer to see in light of the Scottish Government's changes, really? But if you might not have that detail in front of you, but if you have any other proposals about how that amendment might look or what you'd like it to look like, that would be quite helpful for the committee to consider.
I could follow that up in writing. I mean, I've not come with anything prepared, I have to say.
Of course.
That'd be helpful. Thank you.
Thank you. Joe Fitzpatrick.
Very quickly, we're almost out of time. I had some questions around the National Care Service Charter. So I think really just to open it up to any thoughts on the Charter. It's the process around the co-design of it, which was kind of one of the things that has been flagged up as a positive. I want to put in whether actually going forward, if we're going to have a Charter, should that be a living document that can learn from the actual experience of how it's working in practice? And the final area I'd be keen to hear any comments if folk have is around a complaints process and what that might look like. So, Katie, do you want to go first? Any thoughts around that?
Thanks. Yes, again, we support the principle of an NCS charter, but as it stands in the bill, we're not sure what weight or what teeth it would have. You know, the first iteration of the bill was very, human rights focused, and the understanding was that those human rights legislation would then transfer over to the Charter. Obviously, the Human Rights Bill by the Scottish Government is looking no longer in the same way. So I think it really, just to understand what the impact would be of that legislation, and again, in terms of the creation of the Charter, I think it would make sense for it to be a living document, but also it's to ensure that everyone who is either who would like to contribute to the creation of the Charter would have the opportunity to contribute to it in a way that's accessible to them, particularly in communities that perhaps are most impacted by the NCS but don't have the opportunity maybe to contribute to these sort of things. So I think it's just making sure that it's accessible and has teeth and actually is able to deliver something.
Thanks, Katie. Colin?
Yeah, I mean, we obviously agree with the principle, absolutely. I think there is some difficulties, though, in our experience of co-design has given us some concerns through this process, is we've actually seen staff and carers pitted against each other, and that's very, very unhelpful, because I think everybody's trying to get the best we possibly can from whatever perspective you're looking for it. So I think that needs to be really thought about and thought about how we do that better. So a charter is an important thing. The Scottish Government had previously talked about creating a workforce charter as part of the co-design work, but we've not seen an update on that, and I think that would be something that would be worthwhile to work in collaboratively with a charter or as part of, and I think that's something that needs to be explored.
Thank you. Either Keir or Simon, anything further, or are you?
We're certainly broadly supportive of the charter, the complaints issue. It's everybody wants a robust complaints process, but it's really challenging. There's a natural tendency for organisations to be defensive, and you know, we've seen that in the post office writ large. So it's difficult, conflicting rights and responsibilities there, but certainly in the charter we're supportive of that.
Thanks.
Support of the charter, but as Colin mentions, there needs to be a workforce charter around the complaints. I mean, obviously, the SSSC registration for our members is can be very difficult, can be extremely punitive, can lock them out of work for a period of time. And it would be interesting to know what process would be in place that allows workers to bring up such complaints against employers that are not meeting ethical commissioning and meeting their contractual target or are not meeting their fair work obligations. Because from our perspective, we see our members that are paid on very low pay, having very punitive suspensions through the SSSC, but we see no action and no teeth within the bill to take action against employers who take the mickey.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much for taking us exactly up to time there, Joe. I am going to briefly suspend the meeting for a changeover of witnesses. Before I do, I'd like to put on record my thanks to the panel members for their time this morning. We now continue our scrutiny of the Scottish Government's proposed Stage 2 amendments to the National Care Service Scotland Bill with a second panel of witnesses. And I welcome to the committee Pauline Lunn, Director of In Control Scotland, representing the National SDS Collaboration, Stephen Morgan, Chief Social Work Officer for Dumfries and Galloway, representing Social Work Scotland, and Frank Riley, Independent Advisor, Adults and NCS, representing the Scottish Association of Social Work. And we'll move straight to questions and Tess White.
Thank you, Convener. My first question, if I may, ask Frank. So, Frank, what impact, please, would the shared accountability arrangements proposed have on the governance and delivery of social care and support? Thank you.
I think from our members' perspective, any change will be a positive change. But actually, at the present time, the shared accountability arrangements as they stand don't really give us as an association or our members hope for the future. I think the shared accountability as it's been set out in the documents is interesting, but I think the balance between local flexibility, being able to deliver local services that meet local needs, as well as being able to ensure consistency right across the country, is always a bit of a paradox. And our members have been very clear that they are not seeing, certainly within the bill and within the shared accountability agreement as it currently stands, delivering those an answer to that paradox. So the quick answer is our members are waiting to see, and they're hoping for better times ahead, but they're not confident given the relationships between government, local authorities and the NHS as they stand at the moment.
Thank you. And Stephen, do you have a view on that?
Yeah, from a Social Work Scotland perspective, we view the proposals quite confusing, adding layers of bureaucracy as opposed to removing them. If we think about the ministers holding responsibility solely for a strategy, for example, how does that impact on other partners? You know, where does the shared accountability really sit, and where does the power lie? So we have some reservations in terms of impact and how that would operate.
And it has been explained, or some see it as a tug of war, or it will create a tug of war. Stephen, you're nodding, and Frank, you're nodding as well. I can see maybe if I go to Frank on that, because you're nodding.
Our members definitely anticipate that in future. I think our members anticipated the National Care Service creating some form of clarity. There was a gentle in favour direction within our membership for the NCS when it was initially proposed. But that tug of war in particular raises anxieties for social workers. Particularly those who are on the front line, who in reality they're looking at all the discussions around structures and relationships, but the reality is they need resources and they need them now. I mean, the message from the front line is unless we do something about social work and our social care colleagues in terms of investment, there will not be the services, there will not be that technical expertise that sits within social work, because it will be difficult to recruit to train and retain those staff. So I think it's a significant challenge at the moment, which our members hoped the NCS would resolve. And at the moment, they're saying this does not resolve anything.
Thank you. My next question is for Pauline, if I may, Pauline. So to what extent are the proposed amendments and the redrafted bill compatible with the principles and functioning of self-directed support?
So I should just quickly explain, because the other members of the panel have got a particular type of person that they represent in their groups. The National Self-Directed Support Collaboration is much broader. So we have representation from third sector providers, independent support advisors, agencies that provide advocacy, folk with lived experience and local authorities. So we have quite a wide and diverse reach across ours rather than a single focus. So I think there's been strong sentiment that we already have the values and principles of what social care, good social care, looks like through the Self-Directed Support Act. We have that already laid out. We have decades of knowledge and experience of the independent living movement that disabled advocates, self-advocates and activists have worked really hard to ensure that those principles can become a reality. So I think for us, it felt contrary, I suppose, to have a whole new set of values and principles for a National Care Service when we already have a really solid grounding of what good looks like. And it felt just unnecessary, I suppose, for our members.
And in terms of, there is a view that this self-directed support should be a separate work stream to the National Care Service. Would you support that?
So, yes and no. I think the difficulty with having it separate is self-directed support is already seen as something separate to social care when it isn't. It is our national policy for social care for the majority of care and support, excluding residential and justice services. So while it does require attention, I think there's a danger in separating it out because it continues to create that division that it's something different to or separate to self-directed support. Our members would very much recommend and urge for the next stage that self-directed support is the bedrock on which social care is delivered rather than being seen as a work stream in the same way as other topics might be.
Thank you, that's helpful. Stephen, would you like to come in?
Yes, please. I fully agree with what's been said, but for me, when self-directed support was first introduced, we also had the Public Bodies Act and integration at that point, and the two became conflicted. You know, the structural reform around, you know, integration joint boards then and the delivery of self-directed support, the emphasis was on the structural change. Leaders and practitioners were, you know, forced into new structures. We're potentially creating something similar now. You're absolutely right. Self-directed support is the bedrock of what we do. It's a social work assessment. It's a plan for an individual. That social work assessment involves the individual. And then it's the delivery of services. Right now, if we reform in the way that is suggested, we're going to take our eye off the ball that needs an eye on it, in my view, and it's actually going to stall the development that we need. So from my perspective, self-directed support shouldn't be a separate work stream. It's the core of what we do. It goes back to the 1968 Act, if I'm being honest, in terms of how social work and social care practice. You know, people at the centre, giving them choice, giving them agency, giving them control, and that shouldn't change because of structure.
That's helpful. Frank, would you like to comment on that one?
Just to agree with what my colleagues both said, I think the other bit might be missing out of all of this really is the challenges for frontline workers around eligibility criteria for all of these sectors here, really. So social worker roles are really focused on, at the moment, picking up the pieces of broken bits of the system. Social workers want to be talking with people early on in their journey to intervene where they can, provide the early support and to support third sector organisations to do exactly that. But there's an inadvertent or deliberate focus on delayed discharge, which tells us that there's an issue with the system. The system's broken if that's where we're looking rather than the other side. And there's a significant potential we end up stuck in this cycle and not breaking out of it. And I think our members were hoping the NCS would provide us with the tools and the mechanisms to break that cycle. But what we're hearing from our members is that their view is it's reinforcing that cycle and not directing resources and a focus early on in that journey. And that's what's missing from the NCS as a bill. It's what needs to happen for Scotland's future. It's what needs to happen for my future and the future of all of us around the table. And at the moment, that's the biggest concern for our members.
So in the panel's view, are the redrafted amendments compatible with the principles of self-directed support, or does the government need to go back to the drawing board on that as well?
It says with you that there are one or two elements that should be retained, but they don't actually need the bill in order to be taken forward. Those would be the National Social Work Agency. And I'll just look at my notes for that bit, sorry. But I think the bill as it stands at the moment is not going to deliver what social workers intended or expected. That mild support has drifted away really, really quickly. Our most recent engagement, I mean, it's difficult not to express it this way. We were talking to angry social workers who were watching this process, expecting outcomes that would benefit the people they support, not them as individuals. And they're struggling to see how any of this work is going to deliver what was intended at this stage.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the witnesses. What difference do you think the amended National Care Service principles would make to planning and delivery of an integrated health and social care service? anyone in the panel? I think we'll Frank.
I think our view has always been that integrated care of any is an aspiration for us all, to make sure all those bits connect together. There is a dominant voice in the room, and that is the NHS. It has the biggest workforce, it has the biggest amount of resource. And in the Public Bodies Act, as my colleague has mentioned earlier on, it did intend to bring those voices together, but it remains a dominant voice. Our concern is that what's getting lost is the social voice and the importance of relationships in establishing better care at the earliest possible opportunity, and also to begin to look at things like eligibility criteria, which are preventing people who should have access to the care and support that they have. And I'm sure my colleagues would be able to expand on that too.
No, I was just going to make a comment. Yeah, I absolutely agree with with the previous speaker. In addition to that, I suppose working, so we work, my organisation is a national organisation and the collaboration is national. So we have quite a wealth of experience and understanding of how things work in different authorities. And I would say that integration is variable. And I think there is definitely a concern that these dominant voices in the room have led to, it hasn't had a positive benefit as in social care and social work in the way that we might have hoped. I'm sure there are some areas that are positive, but for us in the front lines, we haven't seen quite as much. The big concern that we would have, I suppose, is that with the removal of the lead agency model in Highlands with the proposed amendments, we would hope, we have many members from the Highland area, we would hope that there would be a detailed, separate, specific consultation on what this means for them. I, in my day job, do a huge amount of work with Highland, and they are already facing more challenges than many other areas because of the rurality and the population spread and the geography. And I think there's a danger, I suppose, of assuming that one size fits all in a new national care service without taking the time to really listen to the folk in those communities.
Stephen?
Yeah, I think the position of integration in Scotland is very mixed currently. You know, the Highland model has been mentioned. In Dumfries and Galloway, we have acute services integrated within our local partnership, and then there's areas whereby, you know, children's and justice services be there. And the problem we have in relation to planning and delivery is because there's so many different models, you know, it's difficult to compare and contrast, and sometimes we should, sometimes we shouldn't. But this particular bill and the principles around control at a central level and from the Scottish Government, there's nothing in here that gives us any confidence that the unclarity and the uncertainty that staff and that people in Scotland experience is going to change. If anything, we fear that, you know, there'll be increased levels of bureaucracy. We do welcome some national guidance and some national planning. You know, so for example, you know, if we're thinking about commissioning of the secure estate for the most vulnerable children in Scotland, that's the one that could easily be planned and delivered by the Scottish Government, given the cost, in terms of human cost, financial cost, and the political areas there. But we have no confidence in what's currently before us in delivering the change that's required.
To what extent is there currently a link between fair work and ethical commissioning? And if you don't believe there is a link, do you think there should be? And if so, what should it look like?
There definitely should be a link, and it should be in the bill. We were quite surprised not to see it within the bill. Disappointed would be a stronger word, and that would reflect what our members are telling us too. It's interesting when you look at the systems that we have here in the UK and compare them to those in Europe. When I had recent conversations with colleagues there, they were quite taken aback that there was a separation between social care and social work. They were also taken aback when I described the social work role being narrowed over time to legislative or legislated tasks and away from relationship-based work. And most of that work is now being done by our colleagues in the third sector. That's a symptom of a broken system. Fair Work has a mechanism there to fix that system. We've got a disparity between the pay rates for support workers in the third sector, healthcare support workers in the NHS, and social work assistants. So these are some of the key posts which are delivering relational care right across the piece, and there could be a £2,000 difference between those wage ranges. So Fair Work plays a key role. And I can't emphasise enough, we were really disappointed not to see it within legislation.
You go first. I went first last time.
Okay. Yeah. Again, Fair Work for us, absolutely critical. We need to improve the recruitment, the retention of social care workers in particular into the system. You've already mentioned the disparities between pay. I suppose what's really striking for me, though, is the fact that, you know, the 840 million or 25% increase that was promised into the social care system has gone into meeting Fair Work, quite rightly so. But it doesn't even touch the sides in terms of the investment, the development that the sector requires, not just social care, but social work and community health as well. So, you know, I was going to make a point about investment at some point today. This feels like the right time to make that. We need reform of the social care, the social work and the community health systems in Scotland. Social Work Scotland are strong supporters of that. But without investment to meet the needs of those people who are in difficulties now, but also to meet the preventative needs to invest for the future, we cannot change the system. So Fair Work's critical. You know, ethical commissioning is really important there, but without sustained investment to meet the needs of those people who require it now, but also prevent for the future, then we will not be able to achieve that.
Pauline.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, I would absolutely agree with what's been said already. I suppose taking a self-directed support slant on it, as I'm obviously bound to do, through self-directed support, the person is the commissioner through options one and two, and that is an example of how true ethical commissioning can happen, where there's individualised supports that are developed around a person's outcomes and dreams and what they want to get out of life. And I suppose there's something for us about thinking that we're still, as far as I'm aware, awaiting a full definition of ethical commissioning through that work stream. So it's kind of difficult for us to say, yeah, absolutely, this is the way we should go when we don't have that information. But I think there's lots that we can learn from the way that services can be and regularly are commissioned with the person at the centre, done on a truly individualised basis. And that flies in the face of the kind of traditional competitive procurement processes that we know can often be a race to the bottom and can be damaging to relationships between support providers and local authorities and ultimately kind of harming communities and disabled folk at the end of it.
Thank you. No further questions.
Thank you. Sandish Gohani.
Thank you. And declaration of interest as a practicing NHS GP. Can I ask about social workers? So a recent government bill called the Children Care and Justice Bill in Scotland probably requires something like 150 social workers to make that work. So do you have enough social workers to deliver what the things that you would like them to deliver at the moment?
No is the short answer, you know. Not only did, you know, that particular act say we needed 150 extra social workers, if you look at setting the bar and taking the wheel, two fairly comprehensive pieces of research and follow-up, that showed that, you know, the significant shortages of social workers throughout the country. In my own area, we've done, in Dumfries and Galloway, that being, we've done some exploration of that. And, you know, looking at the workloads of staff on the ground, it can approach ridiculous levels of care. And we don't have the time to do the good quality social work that we want to do. We don't have the time to get alongside people, to have really good equal conversations, to understand the fullness of their life as opposed to the problem that's presented. You know, social workers are stretched beyond belief. So not only do we not have enough, those that we do have are not doing the type of social work that they were trained to do, and that their values and principles hold dear to them. And that's something that your members as well, so I won't speak for you, will highlight. We don't have the time to do what we need to do. So it's a longer answer than just no, but we need significant investment in social work education. We could argue that we need bursaries for social work students so that we can get social workers from all different demographics across Scotland to come into the profession, to give it the richness that it deserves. So there's so many things that could be done differently. So no, we don't have enough social workers.
And I assume then the NCS bill and the money going into it is going to help solve that problem.
If some of the money could come to the front line now, that would partly solve that problem. But the amount of money we're speaking about is insignificant compared to what we would need to fix the whole system.
Can I interject as well? Because I think there is something else, another layer here that's maybe missed often, that the expertise and knowledge that was in social work 10 to 15 years ago has left in droves. So those are the folks who have decided to take early retirement for very good reasons. Actually, some of those reasons are overwork and managing difficult caseloads and trying to support other colleagues. So we do have, from our members, we've heard that there are some teams where the most senior member of staff, so the person with the most experience, has been there for 2 years. Now, that is the problem. You could have lots of social workers. We could suddenly recruit lots of social workers now, but we've actually lost all of that expertise in the interim, and that's dangerous, I think. I think the other thing to keep in mind as well is that the social work, my colleagues mentioned this before, but the social work role should be about developing relationships to allow that earlier intervention. But at the moment, because of high caseloads and a focus on the legislative requirements within local councils and elsewhere to be able to ensure that those elements are actually met, there's a rationalising of what the social work role is. So it's about the things that are easy to measure. How many assessments have you done? How many people have received an output or funding? Any of these sorts of things. We're not measuring the relationships that are absolutely central to social work. And we also now no longer have that level of expertise within teams to support newer social workers to recognise that rational technical work is a tiny proportion of it, and the rest of their work should be in relationships. So our concern as an association and concerns of our members is we're setting up a system that's going to create a particular type of social work that many of our members would not have recognised 25, 30 years ago. More social workers would help, but we need to address this loss of corporate knowledge, which is leaking out the system just now. We need to be able to retain those pieces of expertise. And the NHS did this 10 years ago. And it brought people back in. We need to do something like that, I think, in the system.
I mean, I've been told the average working life of a social worker is around 6 years before they burn out and decide that they can't do this anymore, which is just to the point that you were making there about that level of corporate expertise. Now, when we have the creation of a National Care Service Board and they're going to rename the IJBs and we'll have a whole new layer of bureaucracy, which is what the last panel were telling me. How is this going to impact upon social workers and how is it going to help social workers?
Our members are concerned about that additional layer of bureaucracy. Their gentle approval of the NCS and when it was first proposed was because potentially it would remove those layers of bureaucracy. Their concern is that on a national level, the politics between national and local government will be played out within the National Care Service Board. But the change in name of the IJBAs to Local Care Service Boards is inconsequential. It changes nothing actually for frontline workers. And they had high hopes that it would do. So those are our members' concerns. Politics will be played at the National Care Service Board, and the actual delivery, it won't change anything from their perspective, and it won't address any of the recruitment retention problems or the investment that's desperately needed right now.
Just very quickly to pick up on what you just said there. So are your social workers, that are your members, in favour of the NCS as it's written now?
It was really difficult to find anybody who was.
Thank you.
You've finished, Mr. Gohani?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning to you. It's been quite interesting hearing the different opinions so far this morning. I just want to pick up, Frank, on what you said about the need for social workers not to leave the profession. Leaving in droves is the words you use. Would a national social work agency and creating a national social work lead help address that in terms of looking at leadership, looking at education, looking at flattening the hierarchy on the ground, making sure that social workers know who the leadership is? And, you know, I in my experience as a registered nurse in NHS in Fraser and Galloway, some of the nurses didn't even know who the chief exec was or even who the chief nurse was. So would a national social work agency help address some of these issues?
It's the last best hope for social work. That's what our members have told us. So that's both the agency and having the chief social work advisor in legislation. But we don't need this legislation for that to happen. I think this has been a clear message from our members. Exactly as you've described it, I think the expectations are that the agency will be able to address recruitment and retention challenges, variation in terms of training right across the country, variation in things like eligibility criteria across 30-plus IJBs. But our members are really concerned that whilst the agency is in the legislation and the Chief Social Work Advisor's role is in the legislation, their powers, duties and responsibilities are not. So they are somewhat dubious that later on that will be added. They want to see it now. They want to have confidence that the agency will be able to deliver, and they want to see that in the legislation, not later, now.
So I know Stephen wants to come in here.
So from a Social Work Scotland perspective, including its members and the 32 Chief Social Work Officers in Scotland, we do strongly welcome a national social work agency. But we are really quite vocal in our view that that should not be an agent of the government. We think a true partnership is what's required. We do believe that the Office of the Chief Social Work Advisor needs a firmer footing, and we believe that, you know, moving it forward in the way that's suggested is good. But to give it all of the power and all of the decision-making as a single agency isn't what's required. We need proper partnership with COSLA and with Social Work Scotland and other partners to actually come to the table together to look at what's best for social workers and social work in Scotland. You know, we can look at some of the tricky issues around, you know, I said to myself I wouldn't mention pain conditions today, but it's the first thing that's coming out of my mouth here. We could look at things like pain conditions, but we can look at social work education. You know, so Social Work Scotland and Chief Social Work Officers might have to cede some of their power to other partners. COSLA, as an example, might have to cede some of the local control, and the Scottish Government might have to cede some of the policy making as part of a proper agency that works together and works together well. And that's what we would like to see and what we'd like to continue to be involved in. And we think that will then make a difference in relation to social workers on the ground. I mean, currently, if you're entering the profession today as a newly qualified worker, your pay might vary between £7,000 depending on which local authority you go to work for. So in Edinburgh, you would imagine that Edinburgh would pay more money because it's probably the most expensive part of Scotland to live in. £36,000 social workers start on there. In Aberdeenshire, £41,500. You know, that's just one example. But that's just pay. The support that we get and how we bring people back in to the profession is something that a national social work agency and all of those partners around the table have an enormous voice, and we can do things so much better. So we support a national social work agency, but not in the form as it's currently written.
Do you think a national social work agency would be able to help address issues that were raised with the previous panel about how it's not just about social workers, because we need to work with allied health professionals, occupational therapists, physiotherapists, in terms of like thinking about reablement? We had a conversation about reablement last time we spoke. So how would a national social work agency help develop better partnership relationships with our allied health professionals?
I think it would give social workers' voice back. Since integration, we've, you know, disentangled what was a united profession. So adult social work sit in, you know, health and social care partnerships, some children's services, some justice services do. But where we have got into partnerships, the health element is so huge, it's overpowering and overwhelming for staff on the front line. Currently, we've got staff who are running around attempting, quite rightly, to get people out of hospital because hospital is not the best place for them to be. But that's to the detriment of their social work functions elsewhere in relation to, you know, early intervention, working in the community, and you get pulled to the big white box that is the hospital. You know, you don't necessarily have a voice in terms of decision-making. Social workers in Dumfries and Galloway, who work in the health and social care partnership, look to me as their leader, although I'm not their boss, if that makes sense. But how much impact and how much influence do I have? So a national social work agency, being that, can actually give social work its profession back, its voice, and actually for us to be confident in bringing our voice to the table alongside our allied health professionals to come up with a combined excellent reablement plan, as opposed to a reablement plan that is from one profession only. The 1968 Act, I do go back to that, it gives social workers a role to undertake an assessment. It gives us the responsibility to capture everybody's information for that human being, themselves, the family, and other professionals involved, and for us to collectively come together with a plan. Now, subsequent legislation has strengthened that, but the voice of social work has actually diminished at the same time.
The question, so I'm thinking about what you're saying, like the variation in pay across Scotland, the variation in education, skills, expected competencies, the delivery of what is on the ground. Do you think people know what social workers do? And then also, like, would a National Care Service, the bill with the National Social Work Agency contained within it, help establish a standard approach to what social workers do across Scotland? That's my understanding of the aim of it, so that we can have terms and conditions and salaries and expectations and skills and competencies and education all kind of equivalent across the whole of Scotland.
I think on one hand that's desirable, but we don't necessarily need legislative change or reform for that. We've already got the mechanisms to do that. Scottish Government sets policies, sets budgets, it can ring fence, you know. We could write national standards for social work practice right now. Indeed, we have them in some elements of social work. So that's something that's already within our collective gift. And I suppose that's our proposal from a Social Work Scotland perspective, is it's our collective gift. So let's work better together. It doesn't need expensive structural reform that adds layers and layers upon bureaucracy on top of what we have. We've got health and social care partnerships governed by integration joint boards. We've got children's services partnerships. We've got community justice authorities. We've got national education boards. You know, that goes on and on and on in terms of layers of bureaucracy that actually get in the way. So what we would like to see from a national social work agency is to create clarity in that space.
Can I add to that? Please. So from our members' perspective, there's an existential crisis for social work. There is a concern that social work may not exist in its current form at some point in future. So our members are hanging on with their fingernails to the National Social Work Agency as a mechanism to address exactly those questions that you raised there. But I think there's another question about external legitimacy of the agency if it's exclusively within in government and doesn't have any form of external governance. That's one of their biggest concerns, because what our members don't want the agency to be doing is delivering exclusively government policy. They want a voice in government. They want to be able to influence policy, to reduce the amount of legislation that comes their way for children and families in particular, but elsewhere. But they also want that agency to be able to connect in exactly the way that my colleague has described with local authorities and what happens on the ground, frontline. I'm not suggesting by any manner of means that anybody within the agency would not have those connections. But once you're part of government, it's very difficult to disconnect yourself from what the government's intentions are. And that needs to be very, very clear in this legislation to make sure that it is for social work, not for government policy. It's for social work. And that's what our members are asking for.
So is that the difference between an executive agency and a non-department non-departmental public body?
I think this is another layer on top of that, because I think either of those options could deliver an external governance mechanism, and that was part of the early discussions around the executive agency.
Okay, thanks. Thank you.
Morning, panel. Thanks for your evidence so far. Stephen Morgan, I'd like to go back to something you were discussing there about social work almost getting its voice back. And I guess sometimes when I'm listening to these discussions, I think the other voices that can go adrift sometimes are the voice of service users. And I think it would be helpful to understand, for committee to understand what it means for our citizens when there's structural barriers in the way, when departments are separate. You know, because people's lives don't fall into boxes of children's services, justice services, housing. Can you talk a bit more to that, and also what it means for an individual, what the social worker does for the individual when they have that voice in terms of linking everything up?
I'm just wondering if Paul might like to come in first on that.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm so glad you mentioned that, because I was just thinking we've had a lot of conversation about there's been a few people who are deeply invested in care who've been absent in the conversation. So thank you for shifting the conversation that way. I think so I work personally with a huge number of people who are either using social care or are struggling to get access to social care through self-directed support. I also am part of these collaboration spaces where I hear really similar messages all the time. It doesn't matter if you're in a rural community out in the Ardnamurchan Peninsula or if you're in the east end of Glasgow. There are comparable challenges to people when it comes to overcoming layers of bureaucracy. So I would say that we regularly, and I think our members would agree, have people who don't know where to turn, they don't know what to do. There's even a lack of clarity sometimes that social work is the gateway to be able to get social care support. Folk don't really know that. I think there's a huge piece of education needed nationally for people to, your ordinary citizens, to understand social care and social work, because there are still myths and misconceptions about social workers are have got a bad rep with an awful lot of people. Care and support is stigmatised for many communities, and there are attitudinal barriers in the first instance, but there are also significant structural barriers for dealing with different people, the lack of named social workers anymore, the care management approach where you're funneling people through the assessment, setting up a package, getting them out the door as fast as you can, and not having that. I would liken it to the family GP of old, where you knew where you were going to, you knew the person that knew your family, knew your patch, and was able to give that ongoing support and advice. That doesn't exist in the current model of social work, because we've shifted away from that relationship-based focus into this care management model. So I would say that there are huge challenges faced by supported folks in accessing, navigating, and getting what they need out of social care. And that's not even getting to the difficulties in finding a support service to be able to actually meet their needs, and the thresholds of eligibility criteria, meaning folk are having to be absolutely burst before they can get support. So that's a small number of problems, I suppose it would be fair to say.
Yep. Adding to that, I think, as a social worker myself, I've always taken great pride in being able to speak to people, develop relationships, and enabling people to do the best for themselves. And I sometimes wish I was back doing that job, if I'm being honest. But the job now, especially in care management, can be functional, can be transactional. Mm-hmm. And if a social worker feels that it's functional and transactional, imagine what that must feel like for a vulnerable person whose voice is weaker sometimes, less heard often. You know, social workers are skilled communicators. We understand human growth and behaviour really well. We understand what impacts on people's development and how to attempt with them to put that right. But I said earlier that social workers in Scotland now don't always have the time, or quite often don't have the time, to really get to understand and know someone, to build a relationship. And you're pressured into getting straight into what's wrong with you. And that's absolutely the wrong thing for a social worker to do. It's the wrong starting point. People are coming looking, saying, this is what's wrong with me. They know that it's almost like your five-minute appointment with the GP. You've got to get your issues out there quickly and move on. That's not the way that our profession wants to operate. And we don't want to operate because we are strong advocates for some of the most vulnerable people in Scotland. We wish to continue to be strong advocates, and we want to work in the way that we were trained, and that our values, you know, we hold those core values, social justice in particular, you know, and we're not seeing that we're delivering that for people. So I've also been a social work service user in the past, in terms of being an unpaid carer and getting support that way. And I had a really powerful voice because I know the system. I'm one of the very few who know the system. And you shouldn't have to know a system, you shouldn't have to know a structure to get the best quality assessment and support from a social worker. But your other point around, that's just the start of it. The social work assessment is the gateway to social care support. We also need the investment. And I know I'm going off topic, and I know I'm mentioning, you know, the financial model again, but it's really, really important. We don't have the supports out there across Scotland that's required. We don't have the investment. So we might have the money, but we don't necessarily have the people. You know, so if you're living in Kirkcudbright, in Dumfries and Galloway, or if you're living in the centre of Dundee, you might have different access to a personal assistant. There might be companies in Dundee that you can actually use an option two for. They just don't exist across the piece. So sorry for going off topic a wee bit there, but
Frank, I wonder, would you have any reflections on the bit about structure getting in the way in terms of where different parts of the system are within or out with, I guess, the existing partnerships that we have now?
I think, well, there are different influences, I think, and it's not necessarily a structural one, but I think if you think about why people come into the social work profession, one of the key things that they're taught, actually, within the first year, I used to be a lecturer in the Strathclyde course, is the use of self. There's no time for the use of self. Social workers are coming out of those courses expecting, it doesn't really matter how many placements they have, real life is not the same as a placement, and they're presented with a production line, essentially, not of managers making, but of the systems making in order to get best value. Relationships are not valued at all. And I think just in terms of the structures that exist currently, it makes relationships with other services much more difficult to maintain or to develop. And that's essentially the way we get over this hump or problem with making better connection with the third sector, and exactly what Pauline was describing earlier on, that concept of a GP-type service is exactly what social workers aspire to when they come out of those courses and not being presented with it. The structures as it stands at the moment is leading to some social workers expressing what I would describe as moral injury. And that is one of the reasons why they're leaving the profession at year four, year five or earlier. We don't actually know where they're going. We know that a vast majority of them are going into the third sector, into family services. But the rest of that highly experienced, highly qualified workforce, we don't know where they're going. And that's a bit of a problem for us as a nation, because it could be wasted. It could be being used more effectively elsewhere and raising the profile of those sorts of social work services. But it means that churn is really, really quick. So whilst we have social workers working in the third sector who understand how the statutory element of it works, they've essentially turned their back on it because it's too difficult to work within because of that moral injury. And the last thing I'll mention is that we've heard from members who are going above and beyond their hours, above and beyond their duty, like nurses, like doctors do, putting their hand in their pocket when it shouldn't be done, not telling their managers about this, in order to meet their moral duty, and taking people to appointments at weekend to see their family at the weekend without telling their managers because it's their moral duty. So you've got two elements here. One is a high demand for a service that's exhausting social workers. Their moral duty is also exhausting them. We shouldn't have a system that has these two distinctions. It should be unified, it should be delivering, and it should also be valuing what social workers and social care workers, carers, and people with lived experience who are also delivering care are providing for our country.
Thank you, that's helpful. Thank you, Convener.
Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to the panel. In the last panel, we had a discussion around what are the good things from the bill that could be separated from other things to take a longer look at some of the more structural reform. Obviously, Anne's Law is one of the things that's in there, and a lot of it is actually focused on people who access services, carers and things like that in terms of advocacy, short breaks and things. Are there other things in that good stuff category that those on the panel would want to see progress, and actually many people have said could be progressed without this piece of legislation at all? And Frank's nodding the most, so I might come to Frank first.
I think it's just a habit, to be perfectly honest. Well, thank you for asking the question. I think I've already mentioned the agency is the last best hope for social workers, but it has to be done properly and it has to have the right powers. It needs to be in legislation. It doesn't need this bill to do that. Our view equally is that the Chief Social Work Advisor, again, should be cemented in legislation, and the powers and responsibilities should be there. Again, you don't need this bill in order to do that, and these two things should definitely progress. Anne's Law equally does not need this bill in order to progress, and actually a number of the elements that are currently within Anne's Law exist in legislation elsewhere, and social workers sit right in the middle of negotiating those legal requirements and moral requirements around the demands both on them, carers and the people who are within care homes. My colleague Alison Babbage reminded me that that was one of the key roles that was pushed to one side during COVID, which was where the social worker sat within all of this. Our view is that if social work had been, that we had more members, more, not of our organisation, but of the social work profession, and it was more cemented in legislation, some of the concerns that are raised and would be addressed by Anne's Law would not have arisen during COVID. But we equally support Anne's Law as a mechanism to cement them in legislation in one particular place. But social workers play a very key role within delivery of that.
Pauline was nodding the most next, if that's OK.
Yeah, second best nodder. Excellent, thank you. Yeah, our members were really positive about the addition of... the right to independent advice, information and advocacy. So traditionally or in the past, it's been more likely the right to advocacy. But the right to information and advice from independent sources is critically important. And quite a number of our members in our collaboration come from independent support and advice organisations. And they're the boots on the ground, making sure that people are really empowered, know their rights, have the understanding and the confidence to be able to access support. But where our members would be keen to see it developed further would be for it to extend to folk in residential care, because we feel like that's a group that are often less heard, they're less involved in decision making, they're less able to exercise their ability to advocate for themselves. So we were really positive about that addition, but I think it could even go further.
Really interesting, thanks. Stephen?
Yeah, I mean, I won't repeat Anne's Law. It can be delivered out with a National Care Service Bill, National Social Work Agency, another great thing, if done properly, can also be done out with a National Care Service Bill. I suppose for me, you know, what is good is looking at prevention, early intervention, and driving the money nearer the front line to our citizens. That's a missed opportunity of this bill, because it doesn't give us the detail about how we're going to drive that reform that we absolutely need. So we agree with the reform of social work, social care and community health. It's absolutely and desperately needed right now today. And that's something which the bill states is one of its aims to a degree, but it's not strong enough. The way it's currently framed does not give us any confidence that it can do that. So we had an opportunity to look at the fiscal, you know, the demographic and the governance issues in relation to social work, social care and community health in Scotland with this bill, but it's missed the mark. It's completely missed the mark.
Yeah, absolutely.
One of the points that Pauline made there, just in relation to advocacy, I think we often forget that encountering power is a disempowering experience, and it's not unique. It affects us all, and limiting advocacy to certain groups is bad policy, and it's bad social policy in particular, and it needs to be extended beyond those groups.
That's really useful. Thank you. One of the other things that's been raised is the inconsistent nature, I think you touched on this earlier, Stephen, of integration across the country in terms of children's and justice services, as well as the geographical spread, with Pauline mentioned Highland earlier on as well, and the different model that's there. Given what's in the bill, how much and the potential for children's and justice to come in as well, and the issue with the lead agency in Highland, how confident are you that the current provisions will actually deliver what it needs to? Of what else do we need in there? Is it more detail? Is it going back and taking longer? There's obviously a lot of organisations, including your own, I'm sure, who've involved themselves in some of the co-design processes and things. And one of the things I'm really keen is that we don't burn all of that goodwill and that good engagement that has happened for many organisations through co-design. How do we get to a point where it does give people confidence that this is going to deliver the change that has been needed for the last decade and a half? Stephen.
I was trying to be the best nodder for this particular one. So for me, I don't have any confidence at all right now, if I'm being honest. I know that I speak on behalf of other chief social work officers. As you've said, there are so many different methods of integration. So models are models, but what we've choose to delegate, what we choose not to, where we can choose, is very different across Scotland. The Highland model itself is really concerning in relation to terms and conditions for staff who we believe would then have to come out of, you know, Agenda for Change in the NHS, be re-employed, and, you know, would they have, like, similar favourable conditions. But as the bill currently stands, what's in is in currently and what's out is out. Does that mean where we have children and justice services currently in and they remain in, that those local authority areas can choose to take them out in the future? The extra confusion, the extra bureaucracy is really, really damaging. The in or out question is, it's misleading. It's disingenuous in terms of what does that mean. We know the Scottish Government want things in, you know, so are they going to be in, are they going to be out? Let us know, let us work forward for that. So have no confidence in terms of what we currently have in the bill will drive forward the change that we need. What I would add in terms of how do we get there around confidence in the future? Invest the money that the Scottish Government's currently looking at to have significant structural reform in frontline services just now. Give local people, local managers, you know, local authorities, local partnerships, the responsibility, and other partners, the responsibility to deliver locally, but invest in it where that's required. You know, Feely, 47 recommendations, if I remember right, only one of them was a national care service. Feely looked at the broken social care system that we have in Scotland, and we need to put that right. It needs intelligent, strategic investment in terms of the greater good for all, but investment around the individual services that people currently get. And we've got to actually fund both of those, not one or the other. So in terms of confidence, it's putting our money collectively where our mouth is in order to drive the change that's required. Now, it's not all about money, we've heard that, but it does require significant fiscal resource. But we also, we're all aware of the fiscal challenges. So I think we have to temper what we can actually achieve right now and look at what's realistic. Now, that might not, it's not what I want to hear, it's not what I want to say, but I think we do have to take a step back. And I don't think that the current bill gives, like I said, it doesn't give me or my colleagues any confidence that it'll drive a positive change.
That's great, thank you. Does anyone else want to come in on that?
I think if I can just make another comment on resourcing and thinking from the supported person's perspective. So I know I was part of the expert legislative advisory group, and I know an awful lot of people who are living with disabilities or health conditions or are unpaid carers who have been part of the co-design process. And I think there is a bit of distrust out there now because there has been this what felt like quite a rushed service and process in the ELAG, the Expert Legislative Advisory Group. It was really intense. It was quite time-bound, and it was a lot to difficult for folk to engage meaningfully. And in the co-production sessions as well, I suppose lots of people don't necessarily see themselves reflected in it. I think if you're looking for ways to build up trust again, there's something fundamental around the makeup of the decision-making processes that feels contrary to the ambitions of what I think a lot of us wanted to have in a truly co-designed national care service that values the voices of lived experience. At the moment, folk who are with lived experience on decision-making boards are limited to one rep. There's no other group that's limited to one rep. There's nothing about how they'll be remunerated within that. People are expected to give their time for free. That's not valuing it. There's also a significant cultural shift that will be required. It's really tough if you're used to having power and being able to make decisions and then having to work in a different way. So that training and support is needed for everybody to make it really collaborative. So I think there's something really bold that could happen that is about a real proportionate representation of lived experience that encompasses lots of different types of voices, lots of types of experiences, remunerates and trains them and supports them fairly, and as well seeks to challenge the culture of power that some folk are just more accustomed to.
That's great, thank you. Frank, did you want to come in?
Yeah, I think from our members' perspective, that the fracturing of social work across so many different areas is problematic. It's very unusual for somebody just to fit within adults or just to fit within children and families or just to fit within justice. They're normally right across all three of them. So it makes sense to bring them together, and waiting is not something our members are advocating for us to say to you today. Don't wait, do it now. I think the other thing that particularly what Pauline raised there around the co-design process, good co-design processes and good co-production takes time. We've not had that time. So it's not a terrible surprise that those who are involved feel disappointed with what's been produced. I think if the purpose of some of the discussions today are about rebuilding trust, it needs a longer time frame. But to build a bill, you can't have that longer time frame. We need something now, but we also need that co-design process to go a longer period. And the last thing I'll mention is that we do have some concerns, not just in terms of the representation. Just as Pauline said, an individual can only represent themselves. There's nothing within the bill, within the memo, that suggests that there'll be support around constituencies. So possibly it might be in disabled people's organisations for lived experience, but equally for social workers on local boards. A social worker on a local board will normally represent their employer. There needs to be a separate representation for social work, and probably for the other professions too, because that's a really difficult, I mean, my colleague will probably agree with me there, it's a really difficult tightrope to walk. And you can't expect somebody to have two hats on when they're there. But certainly constituency is something we're really keen to emphasise today.
One final wee comment, sorry, you've just reminded me of the other voice I commented earlier on when the member mentioned folk with lived experience. The engine room of a huge amount of the National Care Service is the folk delivering the support. So it's not just the assessment and the review and the statutory side of stuff. Support, most people receive their support from a support provider, and I think our members felt quite strongly that their voices need to be part of decision making as well. There are some great umbrella organisations out there who represent providers from different sectors. They have a lot to say, and if you don't have providers on side, transformational change will be really tricky, so I think we need to get them in the room too.
I've got time for one more wee one. Okay. Having had conversations with Alison Bavage before about how heavily legislative social work is, are we getting to the stage where we've reinvented the wheel that many times that it's no longer a wheel for social work? And do we need to look at how much legislative governance there is and really get it an awful lot tighter so that the job and the work can actually be done on the ground?
Absolutely. Our members are telling us that they are juggling every day, depending on what legislation they're working within. It's one of the most heavily legislative elements of public sector. It's really difficult to navigate for social workers. There's no surprise then that it's difficult for people who are looking for support to navigate.
When you're working with older people, you could be working with the Social Work Scotland Act, community care legislation, adult with incapacities, adult support protection and mental health legislation, all in one interaction with somebody in terms of their support needs, and trying to work your way through that spider's web can be really quite complex. So yes.
And that's not even taking into account local practice and policy and intelligibility and how that all fits together. So I don't envy them. I'll just give a wee example. This is from my own practice and Control Scotland rather than the SDS collaboration. But I did a piece of work with a group of social workers where we asked them to map out the system to draw how does somebody come in, what happens to them when they're in there, and how do they come out the other end. And we ended up with this massive, really complex, unwieldy piece of paper on the wall. And a social worker took a step back and she said, this is stupid. And I said, what do you mean this exercise is stupid? She's like, no, my job's kind of stupid, isn't it? Basically, my job is to circumnavigate. There are processes there, but they don't work. So my job is to create these little back paths around about the system to get the outcome that I want. And it just devalues the entire system. So I always think about that massive roll of paper on the floor and a social worker's reflection of, my job's kind of stupid, isn't it? I think, actually, the role of social work is incredibly important. Social workers it is not a stupid profession, but what we've done is complicate it and make it unwieldy and challenging for folk to practitioners and disabled people alike to navigate.
That's great. Thanks, Camina.
Thank you. A brief supplementary from Emma Harper.
Thanks, I will be brief. Just to come directly to Stephen, you said that, like, Philly made 53 recommendations, 11 are directly about the National Care Service, so that's 20%, and one of them was to basically have a minister with social care in their title. So we've got that now, Marie Todd's our Minister for Social Care. So you're saying that, like, we can just get on with doing stuff. We can't wait on a bill, but we are working towards it right now. So would you suggest that we just keep continuing to do what we can right now while we're waiting on the bill, because the bill is a framework bill and then further legislation will come down the line?
We have no choice but to continue doing what we're doing. We're here to meet the needs of the most vulnerable people in Scotland, and we have to do that. In terms of what structures look like, we have local structures across Scotland. You know, Public Bodies Act is still in existence. many of us argue that we're still implementing that. And, you know, the reform act could be, you know, around that legislation and what that means in terms of having clarity around what needs to be in, what needs to be out. You know, do we have a definition for, you know, community health services? Is there a clear definition there? I think the answer is no. You know, there is work looking at that. So, yes, we've got the mechanisms, we've got the legislation now to keep going. You know, given the fiscal position of Scotland at this moment in time, I think Social Work Scotland's position would be take a break, pause, reflect. There's a lack of research, there's a lack of detail, but we've got the legislation in play right now to deliver for Scotland's vulnerable people. So give us the money that's set aside for this. Get it to the front line, to people, you know, who live across all of our communities in Scotland, and let's change the system for them now. So we have to get on with it.
Thanks.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks to the panel so far. I just wanted to build on some of the points that have been made so far in relation to Anne's Law, and also maybe the broader point about prevention. A key aspect of this would be housing. So just looking in particular at the forthcoming housing bill, are there any aspects where this could interface quite effectively, and whether you'd like to see better consideration of, for example, adaptations to housing to allow people to live in their homes for longer without having to either be admitted to acute hospitals or to care homes? And also one aspect that I have encountered certainly has been the financial aspect of having to sell your home to fund residential care means it's effectively a one-way decision and there's no going back once that decision is made. And is that something that has ended up with disastrous results for some of your clients in your experience?
So the point about housing is critical. You know, as a social worker, we always go back to Maslow's hierarchy of needs. You know, food, shelter, warmth. And you're absolutely right that, you know, people selling the house is one thing. But quite often, particularly in Scotland, we value our family home. You know, we've lived there, whether we've rented that for forever, whether we've bought that. And it's quite a draw for some people to move on. But when you do want to move on, there's not enough housing in Scotland to downsize. I mean, I'm 52, I've got a dodgy knee, and, you know, I live in a semi-detached Victorian property. But I want to move to a bungalow, planning for the future, so I can have that at home for life, but they just don't exist. When we're looking at aids and adaptations, many properties in Scotland can't be properly adapted. So, you know, again, I think something like 20% of our properties are Victorian properties or older, and many of them just can't be properly adapted. We've got to invest in more social housing, and we've got to invest in housing that's Homes for Lives, universal design. There's different languages that we can use. But we've also got to think about amenity. So when we have got, we had a stock transfer local authority in Dumfries and Galloway, so we rely on our Rochester social landlords, excellent relationships with them. But when they're designing, you know, new housing schemes and, you know, don't just look at where there's a cheap plot of land where you can put X number of units that'll meet the demand, but what does the amenity look like? Where is the shop? Where is the church? You know, where is the doctor's surgery? And we don't think about amenity enough. So you're absolutely right that housing is critical in relation to meeting people's needs in the longer term. We've also got an awful lot of... So we've spoken predominantly, without saying it, about older people and adults today. But we've got care-experienced youngsters entering the homeless system in Scotland right now. You know, we'll put them in bed and breakfasts, inappropriate accommodation. And these are people who are in cycles and cycles of trauma, abuse. Then they come into systems that, you know, they relive that trauma, they relive some of that abuse. And we don't have houses for them. So you're absolutely right that we need that. We can also think about that amenity in different ways for older people around what might a care village look like. Now, a care village is a wonderful term, and you've got to get that amenity right so it doesn't become a ghetto of care, which is another phrase that people use. So passionate about getting this right and how we plan and deliver proper housing and proper accommodation for the future.
Well, I can come in on that as well. I think the system's got some perverse incentives in it, which this legislation is not necessarily going to address. And I think it is about how you get access to services. So at the moment, it would be you have to be in need, you have to be in the worst possible condition that you can be. So it's switching off that earlier intervention that can keep people in their own homes Those relationships that are necessary. So I'm thinking about my mother-in-law, who has now got a connection with the social work department, but later on in her health journey, if that conversation had been had 2 to 3 years ago and before now, and not for want of trying on my behalf, I have to say, then she would have had AIDS and adaptations in her house now that would mean she's got another 10 years within her home. That time frame has been reduced. So those perverse incentives are really important to address. The bill doesn't do that currently. And that's problematic because it's kind of setting up a system where you have the most deserving receiving what they require, but at a point where their lives have got to a point where it's not the most healthy, the most effective lives that they could live. We need to intervene earlier. That's where social work's role is, but it's also our colleagues in the third sector. That's where they want to be. And having worked in homelessness previously, I mean, the challenges around there beyond Anne's Law, beyond the necessity to create non-judgmental spaces for folks to be able to live and grow. It's not just in one particular sector, it's right across our society today. And that focus is problematic. It's almost like going back to the poor law in some respects, and that worries me considerably.
Thank you. Carol Mawkin.
Thank you, Convener. I've listened quite closely in terms of what we can do now, what we should be doing now. I suppose some of our responsibility, though, is to scrutinise, you know, the bill as it progresses. And so I'm interested to know around monitoring. And some of my papers talk about, you know, performance, but really listening to you, I think what we are talking about is, does the bill, does the amendments address outcomes as we would wish to see them for, you know, for the people that we seek to represent and support. And Pauline in particular has been very strong in that. So I wonder if you could talk to us a wee bit about the bill with the amendments as they stand, whether you believe that we can get that right, we can monitor the processes for people and get the outcomes that we're looking to and hold people to account for that.
Go for it. Thank you. Our members definitely agree that a fundamental principle of a rebuilt transformational change national care service should be to set national quality and to be understand if that's being met. The thing for us, I suppose, is data is meaningless if you don't interrogate it, if you don't learn from it. There's something far more powerful in a learning model through human learning systems or improvement science that looks at what does the data mean and how can we learn from it. So we would definitely support not just monitoring data for the sake of it and not just gathering data for the sake of it. There's something a wise man once said to me that services don't achieve outcomes for people. People achieve outcomes. There's no such thing as a service achieving an outcome. That's a fallacy if we believe that. What we can learn, though, from the way that people achieve outcomes is the way to improvement.
Yeah. I'm going to make reference to Ben, who's sitting behind me, because when we're looking at the support and improvement framework, Ben uses a phrase that this is going to have to do the heavy lifting for the NCS. And it speaks an awful lot around scrutiny and quantitative performance measures. That's not outcomes, yeah, as you've said. So having that top-down approach whereby we look at, is an agency, is a partnership, is a whatever performing well enough, and what do we need to do to intervene? Where's the language around improvement and being on that journey together? The fact that we're looking at a model whereby we might take responsibility from one IJB, council, NCS local board, whatever it happens to be, from one to another, so that other authority can get them to where they need to be. I can't think of any local authority or any IJB in Scotland that would want to take responsibility for another area when we're all struggling to deliver what we need to do right now, if I'm being perfectly honest. But also the legal responsibility would still sit with, you know, the original agency, whether that's the authority or whatever else. So it's really quite confusing. So I don't think there's anywhere near enough mention about outcomes for people, whether that's individually or groups, which I struggle with more in terms of groups of people, but there's ways to do that. So I think much more focus has to be given on what we actually mean by outcome. And I don't see anything in the NCS or the associated documents right now that give me confidence that we're looking at improvement in the way that we really mean improvement from a learning perspective.
I can't disagree with any of what's been said, but just what I would add really is, again, it's around what I mean, what can be counted counts as that a kind of physiology and quantitative research, and that's problematic for social work, because social work focuses on relationships, but it has been forced into delivering quantitative elements in order to be measured properly. The framework needs to be able to take account of that, exactly as my colleagues have already mentioned. The quality of the relationship is what social work is focused on. And there are no metrics that I've seen thus far that give us that. So that's something that should be added or explored in detail. Pauline mentioned national standards earlier on. Is that we can do that now. We can set national standards now. We don't need the legislation in order to do that. We share the concerns that Stephen's mentioned earlier on about the transfer of powers from one local authority to another. We are struggling to see how that can be done under the existing legislation safely. And the last thing I'll mention is that there's already quite a lot of burdensome bureaucracy, which came up in the previous question, on social workers. This other layer, it's difficult to see what that additional layer would add that would be beneficial without rationalising the other layers that already exist. And it has to demonstrate value. And it can't just be in those quantitative elements. It has to be in terms of the quality of what's been produced.
So am I right in picking... Sorry, am I
We've
right?
got to move on to another theme. We only have 5 minutes
right,
left.
Okay. I'm picking up rightly that we don't. That monitoring seems to be based on process rather than what is really important in this area is that quality for the individual that we provide the service and their family. Thank you very much.
That would be transformation in social care.
That would be transformative if we started measuring that.
Thank you.
Thank you for your bravery.
So my questions, the themes around the National Care Service Charter, just to give you an opportunity to say something about that. Keen to hear your thoughts on whether the charter will be effective, the co-design process, and I'm keen personally to hear if you think it might be good if that was ultimately a living document that could develop as we get experience of the National Care Service. And then finally, if you have any thoughts on what a complaints process might look like for the proposed National Care Service.
So, Social Work Scotland's view is that Scottish ministers need to get on with it in terms of a charter, a guide to your rights. Just do it now. It doesn't need a National Care Service bill. We need to be really clear about that. The charter itself, we don't think, makes sufficient distinction between legal rights possessed by the individual and, you know, legal duties, which... you know, individuals, organisations subject to. So we think, you know, that needs to be clarified. But yeah, the short message would be get on with it.
Pauline?
Just an additional bit, because I know we're short on time, would be, agree with that so far. There was a couple of technical points. I suppose there's reference made to just independent access to independent advocacy rather than advocacy information and advice as well. And from our perspective, it's not particularly accessible. We had a problem with accessibility throughout this consultation process where there was incredibly complicated, difficult to navigate information. So it does limit your ability to meaningfully engage with a wide group of people.
I ask you just to expand a little bit on the differences between, because I think it's a really important point, independent advocacy and independent advice, and just for the record, so we can have that on our...
Yeah, so there are a number of independent support I'll use self-directed support as the example, because that's where I live. There is a programme called Support in the Right Direction, funded by Scottish Government through the Self-Directed Support Transformational Fund, which allows there to be an independent support organisation in every local authority. So they're able to tailor support and advice around about the whole journey of self-directed support to help people navigate, get involved and get what they need out of their support. Advocacy is quite specific in terms of dealing with times of challenge or where there's a risk of somebody not having their voice heard. So to have either is not the full picture, you do need both.
Helpful, thank you, Anne.
Brief. There are no your rights, no duties, new duties within the Charter. We struggle to see what the benefit of it is. You asked about complaints earlier. the way it's described is it's quite a simple process. Social work complaints are not simple. I'll just give you an example. A complaint about funding, a funding package for services that a social worker or the social work department has determined is conditional on availability of those resources. It's also conditional on the needs of others who may have been assessed to have priority. That makes it very, very complex, but that's not how it's been presented.
Much.
Thank you. Can I thank the panel for their evidence this morning? That's been very helpful to the committee in its scrutiny of stage two of the bill. The panel are free to leave, but the committee will continue on with their work. The next item on our agenda is consideration of a negative instrument, National Health Service Free Prescriptions and Charges for Drugs and Appliances Scotland Amendment Regulations 2024. The purpose of this instrument is to amend the National Health Service Free Prescriptions and Charges for Drugs and Appliances Scotland Regulations 2011 in respect of prescription charges applied to English prescription forms if presented for dispensing in Scotland, and this is in alignment with the increased charges in England. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered the instrument at its meeting on the 17th of September 2024 and made no recommendations in relation to this instrument. No motion to annul has been received in relation to the instrument, and ask members if they have any comments. I propose, therefore, that the committee does not make any recommendations in relation to this negative instrument. Does any member disagree with this? Thank you. At our next meeting next week, we will continue taking oral evidence on the Scottish Government's proposed Stage 2 amendments to the National Care Service Scotland Bill with three further panels of witnesses. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today.